I saw a funny post the other day on social media that said this. It said, if Trump wins the next election, I'm leaving the United States. Then it said, if Biden wins the next election, I'm leaving the United States. It said, this is not a political post. I just really want to travel, you know? and I thought that was quite funny, right? But as I was thinking about the introduction of this message, just the mention of those two names creates some disunity, a little buzz there, creates some disunity and creates a little bit of tension and angst in the room. Both of their campaign managers in the past few years have done a wonderful job of revealing the disunity that exists in our country. And here's the thing, it's always been there. It may be more exaggerated at this point, but it's more visible at this point because of what we see in social media and what we see online. But what they did is they just appealed to a natural disunity that actually exists in every human being on the planet, because I don't know if you know this or not, but human beings naturally struggle with unity, don't we? We struggle with unity when it comes to politics. We struggle with unity around certain social issues. And sadly, sometimes even the church struggles with unity, don't we? And so as you look around our culture, maybe as you look around your previous church context, or maybe even our current church context at times, you'd say, man, well, Brian, is unity, is it even possible? Is it even attainable for us to be one, together, unified? I think it's a great question. And it's actually a question that Jesus actually answers in John 17 in his high priestly prayer. Now, if you were with us previously for this series, we're picking this up about three quarters of the way through the series. If you were with us before, we saw in the first five verses of John 17 that Jesus prayed and he asked God the Father to glorify himself through the life and death of Jesus. That was the big part, the big thrust of his prayer. And we covered that last time. If you want to check it out, you can go check that out on our website. Today, what we see Jesus address and what he prays for is that Jesus actually prays for unity and oneness among believers. It's a theme we're going to see threaded all throughout the rest of this chapter. And what we're going to see is that through this unity, we will bring glory to God as well. Now, in the second part of the prayer here, what we're going to find is where this unique unity is found, where it rests. And it's found in three ways. Let me show them to you. The first one is this. Unity is the result of genuine faith in Jesus' message. Unity is the result of genuine faith in Jesus' message. John 17, verse 6. Let's look at this together. John 17, verse 6. I have revealed you to those whom you gave me out of the world. Pause there for just a moment. When Jesus says, I have revealed you, really what it is it sums up the whole life and ministry of Jesus in his time here on earth. Jesus revealed who God is and ultimately revealed God's love for us. We could sum it up this way. We only know who God is fully to this extent that we have today because of what Jesus showed us. Jesus showed us the character of God. He showed us the love of God. And without Jesus having come, it might be that God would seem like some distant dictator or some mythical sky fairy that we know nothing about. But because of Jesus coming and his revelation or his revealing of God the Father, we know who God is. He continues. Look at the rest of the verse. I've revealed you to those whom you gave me out of the world. They were yours. You gave them to me, and they have obeyed your word. See, this is the reason that Jesus came, as the perfect revelation of God the Father, to show us who God is, to display his love for us, and to die on a cross to restore back to God those who would believe and obey what he said. And Jesus says here very clearly, this is the first part I want us to dig into. He says the disciples believed and they obeyed the word. Everyone say word. See, in John's account, this is just great for Bible study as you guys continue to kind of pre-read through the rest of this gospel. In John's account here in his book, when Jesus refers to his word singular, okay, he's referring about to his message as a whole. He's referring to the gospel as a whole, okay, what he came to teach us. In short, you might have heard the word gospel thrown around at church a few times, but maybe if you're new, you wonder a little bit of what that is. Put in the simplest terms possible, the gospel is the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus for the sins of the world. It's what's known as the good news, of Jesus. That we can be saved not through our works, not through our efforts, not through our good intentions or our church attendance or our good deeds, but that we can be saved. The good news is we can be saved because of the work that Jesus has done for us on the cross, and we can be restored back to God again. And here's what he says here about his disciples as he opens this prayer. He says the disciples have believed and obeyed his word, the gospel. They may not understand it all fully, but they possessed the simple childlike faith that's necessary for salvation. And their belief, get this, their belief and their obedience to the gospel meant their sins were forgiven. And that's actually the first step towards the unity that we're looking for today. Now you might think, well, what does our sins being forgiven, what does my sins being forgiven have to do with unity? Well, I'm really glad you asked, okay? Here's something you should write down as well. Write this down, and this is a great one to be reminded of every day. Sin always disrupts, divides, and separates. Sin always disrupts, divides, and separates. Let's say this one together. You ready? Go. Sin always disrupts, divides, and separates. See, we see this. You guys just came through the Christmas season. You spent some time with extended family, didn't you? Your sinful selfishness of your brother or sister-in-law, or maybe your mother or father-in-law, probably caused some separation or some division over an argument or something around the tree at Christmas, right? That inevitably happens when you get together with extended family, okay? Sometimes our sinful selfishness divides us in our relationships with other people. We also know that our sin is what separated us from a holy God. What Adam and Eve did in the garden when they ate of the fruit and they disobeyed God's command plunged humanity into sin. Each of us is born with a sin nature that separates us from a holy God. There's a chasm between us and God that can only be crossed with the cross of Jesus Christ and his sacrifice there. And we know sin divides us from other people. Sin divides us from a holy God. But maybe there's one you haven't thought about before. I thought this was fascinating. Sin also disrupts our unity even within. Now think about this for a minute. Sin actually divides us within our own selves and turns us against ourselves. See, we all experience the power that sin has to divide us before we come to Christ. For sure, we're chained by that sin, okay? Now, we can experience this even after we come to Christ as well, if we're not fully submitted to the Holy Spirit, for sure. But you completely feel this before you know Jesus Christ, this division and this disunity within you. Think about it for a minute. Here's one thing I know about every person in this room. No one looks out for your own best interests better than you do, right? Yes? Okay? Like when someone brings a pizza to the break room at work, like you don't ever go in there and pick the smallest, scrawniest, dried out looking piece. What do? You get the big one that has the most toppings and the most cheese, you know? Am I the only one who does that today? Y'all are looking at me like I'm crazy, all right? I know you guys do that, right? And that's a simple illustration, but each of us looks out for our own best interest, and that's just the natural posture of human beings. I'm not necessarily knocking that right now, but here's the reality. If we're the ones looking out for our own best interest, even though that's the case, the unbridled power that sin has in our lives before we place our faith in Jesus, it causes us to do things that are actually harmful to ourselves, right? You think about it, fellas, maybe it's a relationship with someone at work. Maybe it's another woman that's at work that she's attractive and she thinks you're attractive or she thinks you're funny or whatever it is. And you know, if you spend some time around her desk or you spend some time, you know, in her cubicle or in her corner or whatever that is, you know the detriment that could bring upon your marriage. You know the harm that it could do to your relationship with your spouse. You know that it could break up your family if things continue down that path and you continue to engage in that relationship with her closely and you keep hiding those texts and those Facebook messages from your wife. You know where this could lead, and yet you found yourself continuing down that road. So you know what's best for you is to have a great family and a great marriage, and yet your desires within are divided. They're disunified, and you give in to that sin, and you give in, and you continue down that road. You know, for some of you in the room, this was your story before Christ. You knew what that substance would do that you used to get high, or that alcohol you used to drink too much of each night of the week. You knew what those substances would do to your body in your attempt to escape reality for a few moments, or for an evening, or for a weekend. You knew it was harmful to you. You knew what it would do to your body. You knew that it might even take your life if you continue to abuse it. And yet that unbridled power that sin has in our lives before Christ divided your desires, and you laid aside what was best for you, and you picked up and you did what was harmful to you. Is that making sense? Are y'all with me this morning? See, this is what happens, and you have really no control over before you come to Christ. It's your slave master. Sin is your slave master. Now, once we come to Christ, we can still give in to those things. There are still things that I struggle with. There's still things you believers in the room struggle with. But by the power of Jesus and the power of the Holy Spirit, we can have victory in that. But what I'm saying here is this. Sin naturally divides us. And you could think about it this way. Write it down. Sin always disrupts our unity within, with God, and with others. Sin disrupts our unity within, with God, and with others. It is a natural divider, disruptor, and separator. And if we're ever going to find the unity that we're looking for with others on the outside, you must first find that unity with God on the inside. How in the world are you going to be united with other believers if you're not even united with yourself on the inside? How are you going to be united with other believers if you're not united with God in a right relationship with Him? And so here's what I would challenge you with as we begin today. Have you believed in Jesus' message? Have you placed a genuine faith in what Jesus did for your sin? I'm not saying have you come to church your whole life. I'm not saying do you serve. I'm not saying any of those things. I'm not saying do you give money to charity and help little old ladies across the street. Has there been a point in your life when you saw yourself as a sinner who could not save yourself or pay for your own sin? And have you believed that what Jesus did on that cross counted for you? That's the genuine faith that the disciples exhibited here. They obeyed and believed Jesus' word. They believed His message, and that's the first step toward unity. Let me give you another one. Number two, unity is the result of submission to Jesus' teachings. Unity is the result of submission to Jesus' teaching. Look at verse 7. Now they know everything you have given me comes from you. For I gave them the words. Now that one's plural. We'll come back to that in a minute. You gave me and they accepted them. They knew with certainty that I came from you and they believed that you sent me. Now while Jesus' word, singular, that we've been talking about, refers to His message, the gospel, in John's account, when Jesus refers to His words, plural, He's talking about the precepts, the teachings, the commands He lays down about life, okay? And Jesus taught about all kinds of things. His primary message was the message of the kingdom. Believe in me as the Son of God, as the Messiah, and you will have eternal life, and you'll have abundant life in this one. That's the kingdom message. That's for certain the main message. That's what He said most. But Jesus talked about all kinds of things with His disciples. Jesus talked about marriage. Jesus talked about money. Yes, I used the M word on the first Sunday I preached in the new year, okay? He talked about money. He talked about how we're to handle it. He talked about how we're to look at our possessions. He talked about how we're to serve other people when He taught the disciples how to wash one another's feet. He taught His disciples about how to handle the government, even a government that wasn't really in their favor. We don't ever experience that here in America, do we? Right? He said, this is how you're to handle it. You're to give to Caesar what's Caesar's and give to God what's God's. He taught them so many different ways in which to live, and they submitted to it. Now listen closely. Even though the disciples hadn't fully conformed to everything Jesus taught, they were fully submitted to doing their best to follow Jesus' commands as best they could. They didn't understand everything Jesus said, but they obeyed what He said, and they accepted Jesus' words even when others didn't. Do you guys remember back in John chapter 6, which feels like that was like 2 years ago when we covered that, because it's taken us forever to get through this book. But back in John 6, whenever Jesus is telling the people there, He says, I am the bread of life. And then He tells them something really difficult. He says, unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, He says, you have no part with me. As in, you're not going to be saved. You're not going to have eternal life. Well, there were a bunch of people that called themselves disciples that were following Jesus at this time. And after He tells them that, those disciples, you know what they said? They said, man, this is a hard saying. Who can do this? I'm not taking a bite out of this guy. What's he talking about? And because they didn't fully understand what Jesus taught and commanded, you know what they did? It says they no longer followed Jesus and they walked away. And Jesus was left with the 12, right? And we know all of them made it except for Judas, and He's going to address that in a moment as well. But I love what when Jesus turns to the disciples in that moment, what He says to Peter, the question and the response of Peter. Jesus turns to the disciples after all these people, probably hundreds if not thousands of disciples, walk away because they don't understand what Jesus has just commanded. And He turns to them and He says, will you guys leave too? And Peter said some crazy things. Like, we give Peter a bad rap, but Peter got this one right. Peter looks at Jesus and he says, Lord, to whom else shall we go? He said, you have the words of eternal life, and we've come to believe that you're the Holy One of God, that you are the Son of God. You're the Messiah we've been looking for. So if you tell us that every morning we have to wake up and stand on our head in the corner of the room for 2 hours, we're going to do it, even if it doesn't make sense, even if we don't understand it. And I'm telling you, in that instance in John 6, his boys, the disciples, did not get it. They had no clue what he was talking about. But they were willing to submit to anything Jesus would share with them and anything Jesus would command of them. Even when they didn't understand it, even when maybe they didn't agree with it, even when they didn't get it fully, they submitted to his teachings and they were fully committed and faithful to it to the best of their ability. And I think that does have a very simple application in part for us today. It means this. You cannot understand all the answers and still follow Jesus. That there will be parts of the Bible you don't fully understand. And I'm going to tell you this. I've been studying this book for a lot of years. I've probably been studying it for somewhere around 25 years, okay? I've been in ministry for almost 20 preaching out of it. There are aspects of God's Word that are still a little bit fuzzy and gray to me, right? And we can take that and we can say, well, if I can't fully understand it, then God's not very big. No. That actually ought to increase our view of God. That this amazing, infinite being, God Almighty, knows and understands, has a grasp on things better than we do. That's actually something that ought to inspire worship, not walking away and not following him anymore. You see, the thing is we can follow Jesus and not understand everything. There are some things in your Bible that Jesus has commanded that you're going to disagree with. There are some things in the Bible that Jesus has commanded, or by way of his disciples and the other letters of Paul, you're not going to like, you're not going to understand, you're going to say, man, that doesn't fit with our culture today. This is 2023. That doesn't fit. No. The disciples were submitted to all of it, and that's our job today too as a church, that we not only place our faith in Jesus, but that everything he's taught us past that point of salvation, we believe it, we accept it, and we obey it no matter what it is, no matter the cost. I mean, think about it with the disciples for a minute. What if that group, so it's what unified them as a group, number one, but what if they had all come to Jesus and said, you know what, I'm just going to pick and choose the things I like and don't like, and I'm going to obey certain parts and not obey other parts, okay? I like what Jesus had to say about the marriage stuff, but I don't like what he had to say about the money. I don't want him having access to my bank account, so I'm rejecting that piece. And they all came with their own different standards or their own different rules. They would have been a disunified mess, would they not have? Think about it this way. How many of you guys watched the World Cup a few weeks ago, okay? First of all, I'm really sorry you were that bored, okay? That's suffering right there. It just is. You know what I'm saying? But think about the World Cup soccer for a minute. In soccer, there are rules and standards to guide the game, right? In soccer, they're more like suggestions than actually hard, fast rules, you know, because, you know, what sport do you just add an indefinite amount of time onto the end of the clock based upon the whim of the referee? Or, like, what sport can you actually end in a tie? Or what sport bases the fouls based on which team has the better acting ability? You know that? But I digress, okay? That's all the things to knock our soccer fans in the room. Think about soccer rules for a minute, though. Imagine if a team showed up to the World Cup a few weeks back and each player on that team decided, you know what, I'm going to pick the rules I like and the rules I don't like, and I'm going to live by those. I'm going to play by those rules. And one guy shows up, and he says, I'm going to play by basketball rules. And so instead of passing the ball with his feet and kicking it down the field, he picks up the soccer ball and dribbles it down the field and dunks it into the top of the goal, into the net, right? That's one guy. Another part of the team comes, and he says, I'm going to play by baseball rules. And every time the ball was kicked to him, he would kick it as hard as he can in an attempt to get a home run into the stands, and he would run all four corners of the field like it was a baseball diamond. And then another guy said, you know what, I'm going to play by American football rules, which is the real football, by the way, okay? I'm going to play by American football rules. That's the only amen I'm going to get out of some of you men today, all right? I get it. And this guy just decided, I'm going to tackle everybody in sight. Now, I actually would pay to watch that. That would be pretty cool to watch that, right? But imagine that for a minute. Everyone shows up with their own standards. Everybody picks and chooses the rules that they want to abide by or play by or the standards. What would you have? You surely wouldn't have a team, would you? You would have a disunified mess with everyone bringing their own ideas and their own standards to the game. There would be no victory because there would be no unity. It would have been the same in the case of the disciples here. But the disciples came to Jesus with this willingness and submission to whatever he said, even if they didn't understand it, even if they didn't agree with some of it, even if it didn't make sense to them, and they were willing to submit to every aspect of his teachings, and it unified them together. Let me tell you this before we move on. The same should be true of us as a church today. We don't get to pick and choose the parts that we like and don't like. We don't get to pick and choose the kind that we're like, oh, you know, that's archaic. I mean, this is 2023. Times have changed. We don't have to use that anymore. We can ignore that part of the Bible. We don't do that. We submit ourselves fully to the teachings of Jesus, and unity will be the result of our submitting ourselves to the standards of God's Word. So before we move on, let me ask you, are there areas of God's Word where you refuse to submit? Are there areas of God's Word where you say, you know what, I like what he has to say about serving other people, but I don't like what he has to say about the whole government thing. I like what he has to say about the marriage thing, but I don't like the part he talks about money. If that's the case, might you repent and confess that and move on from that today and begin to submit yourselves to Jesus' teaching? It's going to create unity in this body as we all submit ourselves to the same standard of God's Word. If you guys are with me, say yes. Look at verse 9. Let's go. Verse 9, I pray for them. I'm not praying for the world, but for those you've given me, because they're yours. All I have is yours, and all you have is mine. And glory has come to me through them. I will remain in the world no longer. He's saying, I'm going home. I'm coming back to heaven here soon. But they're still in the world, and I'm coming to you. Holy Father, protect them by the power of your name, the name you gave me, so that they may be one as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them, and I kept them safe by the name that you gave me. None of them has been lost except the one that was doomed to destruction so that the scriptures would be fulfilled. We know he's talking about Judas Iscariot there, one of the 12 that would betray him. Verse 13, I'm coming to you now, but I say these things while I am still in the world so that they may have the full measure of my joy within them. Did you know that's a direct byproduct of unity in the church? There's a unique, special measure of joy when we are unified. The full measure of Christ's joy. He'll go on to tell us why momentarily. Verse 14, he says, I've given them your word, and the world has hated them, for they're not of the world any more than I am of the world. Now, we've talked about this already, but let me review a bit here when he talks about the world. When Jesus talks about the world, he's not talking about the physical planet. He's not talking about the dirt and the grass and the trees and the hills and the tumbleweeds and whatever else. Okay? That's not what he's talking about. What he's talking about is the world's system of rebellion against God. Okay, it's the world's system of rebellion, as in it's the world proverbially shaking their fist at God and saying, we don't need you. We know what's best. We'll guide ourselves. We'll make our own rules. We'll do what we want. That's the system of the world. And he says, those people in the world who have not placed their faith in Jesus for salvation are still living and subscribing to the world system. And he says, those people that are subscribing to the world system of rebellion, get this, there will be times when they will hate you as Christians. Do you ever find yourself being hated by anyone else? I'm not saying be hateable, okay? Some of us can be disagreeable and grumpy, and that makes us hateable. I'm not saying that at all. But is there ever a point in your day-to-day life, is there ever a point in your week when you're hated? Now, often in this context, it actually would be physical suffering. I mean, some of these guys, we know all these guys were going to die for their faith. Like, they were literally going to be physically killed because the world hated them, okay? Thankfully, in the United States, in 2023, that's not the case. But what it often looks like for us is not a physical suffering, but it's a rejection in our culture. And this is what I would challenge you with on this point. Is there ever points in your life when you're rejected by those who are not following Jesus? Are there ever points in your life where you're rejected by the world? Because if there's not, you're way more unified with the world than what you're supposed to be. Now, we're going to get into a few minutes here. We're going to talk about how to reach lost people and how we're supposed to interact with the world to an extent. But if you're never rejected by the world and you feel just as comfortable and just as at home around people that don't know Jesus, that ought to give you pause. It ought to make you do a little checkup to say, man, Jesus promised that his followers were going to be hated by the world and rejected, and I'm never hated and rejected. So you do the math and tell me what that equates to, church. Like, are there times when you are rejected? Because there should be when it comes to the world. We don't need to be hateful, but there ought to be times when we're hated because we're faithfully obedient to Jesus' teachings, and that life that is different than the world is indicting to the world. Look what he says. Let's keep going. Verse 15. He says, my prayer is not that you take them out of the world, that's really important, but that you protect them from the evil one. They're not of the world, even as I'm not of it. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world. For them I sanctify myself, that they too may be truly sanctified. Listen, what Jesus does when you place genuine faith in him is this. He pulls you out of the world and saves you. He cleans you up. He makes you his son or his daughter. You become part of his family. But do you know what he doesn't do next? He doesn't sit you on a shelf to be a pretty little trophy in his corner. He actually takes you as that saved, changed, different one who is a part of the family of God, and he pushes you back into the world again. You see, the world needs us. The world needs us to be the salt and the light that Matthew 5 talks about. What does salt do? Salt influences everything it touches, right? Like you put salt on something, it changes the flavor of it. That's our job, part of our job in the world. What does light do? Light presses back darkness. That's our job in the world. Without us being the light in this culture and in this world, there is no light in this culture and in this world. And so Jesus doesn't save us to sit us on a shelf. He saves us and he pushes us back into the world because the world needs us. But let me share this with you. You and I need the world too as Christians. See, the world needs us, but we need the world as well. Let me explain it this way. Years ago, when codfish became like a trend in restaurants, it was like a very trendy thing to eat codfish. These codfish were caught in the Pacific Northwest. They were caught and killed, and they were frozen, and then they were shipped across the country to different restaurants. But what they found as they were shipped across the country and they were frozen for days on end is that the meat of the fish was actually arriving flavorless, okay? It tasted like tilapia by the time it got to the restaurant. If you don't know, tilapia is the cucumber of fish, all right? Zero flavor. It only tastes like what you put on it, all right? Dunk it in ketchup, dunk it in barbecue sauce, whatever you like to do. No flavor to it. That's how it was arriving. So they thought, well, a fix for this, maybe if we send them alive instead of freezing them. And so what they did is they took saltwater, seawater tanks, and they put the live fish in there, and the codfish, and they would ship them across the country. Well, it fixed part of the problem. They got there with a little bit more flavor than what they had, but the problem was is they were arriving mushy. And the texture of the meat was not firm like it should be, and no one wanted to eat it. So someone really smart decided, you know what? What we should do is we should actually take the natural predator of the codfish, which is the catfish, and we should stick those bad boys in the tank with the codfish and transport them across the country that way. You know what they found? The constant alertness and awareness, the constant movement and dodging of the catfish as they were, the codfish as they were running from the catfish in the tank, it kept the meat flavorful and tasty, and it kept it firm. Are y'all with me? We need the world in the very same way, church. See, the temptation for some Christians is this. The temptation for a lot of Christians when they come to Christ is to isolate from the world, okay? Isolate. Let's build the bunker, get shotgun shells and canned goods, and pray for Jesus to come back. That whole thing, all right? Like that's the I want to live in a place where everybody's just nice and it's happy and people love God and they love each other and it's wonderful. You are describing a real place, but that real place is heaven, okay? And that's not going to happen here on this earth. And that's not what Jesus prays for here for his people. He doesn't pray for his followers to be pulled out of the world and stuck on a shelf. He doesn't pray for them to be pulled out of the world and taken to heaven straight away as soon as they trust Christ. No, he prays for us to go back into the world because the world needs us to reach them, and we need the world as well. Jesus saves us, and he sends us back into the world, back into the darkness. And in the world, listen to me, you're going to be pressed, you're going to be rejected, you're going to be persecuted. But we need that because what it does is when we're pressed and we're persecuted in the world, it pushes us closer to Jesus, doesn't it? It shows us more of our dependence on him. And you know the second feature of that as well? The second part of that is this. When we're pressed and we're persecuted and what we experience outside of the church is disunity and pressure and persecution, it pushes us closer to other believers and it actually fosters the unity that Jesus is praying for. Isn't that interesting? Almost like he planned it that way. See, the world actually presses us towards and pushes us. Yes, it's painful. We don't like it, but it pushes us towards the unity that Jesus is praying for right here. The world needs us, but we need the world to produce the unity that Jesus requires of the church. Look at verse 20. Jesus says, "My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message." Pause there for a moment and think about this. Jesus right there is praying for you. He says, my prayer is not just for the disciples by themselves. I'm praying for the people in the future who are going to believe through the disciples' message. Jesus was praying for you. He knew the suffering that you were going to face in the future. He knew the temptations that you were going to come up against in the future. He knew the persecution and the chasing from those catfish you were going to face in the future. And Jesus, the Son of God, prays for you. Isn't that powerful? See, people like when the pastor prays for them. And I love praying for people. I'm happy to do that. If you bring me a request, I'll put it on my prayer list, and I'm happy to pray for you. But sometimes people think that the pastor has like a better channel to God than they have. I'm here to tell you, I have the same channel that you do, Jesus Christ. He's my way to God. That's the only way. That's the only way any of us have access to Him. But people think, man, if I get the pastor to pray for me, that's a really powerful thing. I will definitely get that job. They will definitely accept our offer on that house, et cetera, et cetera, if the pastor prays for me. Think about this. Jesus, the Son of God, the Messiah, is praying for you right here. 2,000 years ago, was praying for you. And if you were to read Hebrews 7, you find out that he lives to intercede for us even now. He's praying for you. That's a powerful thought. Go with that truth this morning. Let that be an encouragement. Let that be wind in your sails today. And he prays specifically here in this prayer for us, for oneness and for unity. Look what he says in verse 21. That all of them, all that believe, may be one. Everyone say one. That's unity. Father, just as you're in me and I'm in you, may they also be in us. He says in the same oneness that the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit exist in, that Trinity, it's the word we call Trinity, okay? That perfect harmony, that unity. He says, I want them to experience the very same thing. May they also be in us so that the world may believe that you've sent me. Our unity is actually attracting the world to salvation, he says. I've given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one, I and them, and you and me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you've sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Father, I want those you've given me to be with me where I am and to see my glory, the glory you've given me because you loved me before the creation of the world. Righteous Father, though the world does not know you, I know you, and they know that you've sent me. Verse 26, he closes. I have made you known to them and will continue to make you known in order that the love you have for me may be in them and that I myself may be in them. You know what I see in those last few verses of Jesus' prayer? I see the third piece of where unity is found. Write it down. Number three, unity is the result of commitment to Jesus' mission. In that section, he gives you a very clear indication of what his mission is. Jesus, make no bones about the fact that he came to seek and to save the lost. See, Mark and Matthew both give the scripture and the quote from Jesus. And when he says, the Son of Man, Jesus, he says, I didn't come to be served. I came to serve and to lay my life down as a ransom for many. His goal was to come to seek and to save the lost. Jesus didn't come on vacation to this earth for 33 years. It wasn't a thing to come check on it and see how things were going. He didn't have his dad send him out to check on how the earth was rotating and how people were doing down here. No, he came with a specific mission to seek and to save the lost, and he would do that by way of a sinner's cross that he did not deserve, but he would die and raise again for the sins of the world so that we could be saved. That was his mission. He was all about lost people. And let me tell you this today. As the church, we cannot forget that that is our mission as well. Our mission as a church is to reach the lost. And Jesus here prays for unity, and unity has a very big part in that. Unity has a huge part in that. Write this down. Our mission is what creates our unity, and our unity is what helps us accomplish our mission. See, when we're all committed to this mission, along with Jesus, of reaching the world with the gospel, it unifies us and points us in the same direction. And at the same time, that unique, attractive unity is a magnet to people in the world that don't know Christ yet. See, there's no reason why this group of people should be gathered here today. With some of your backgrounds and some of your family history, there is no reason that all of us should be gathered together today, aside from Jesus Christ saving you and cleaning you and sending you back into the world and us being on the same mission together, right? Like, there's no reason why any of you should hang out together, right? But we're called together as one body, as the church, because we've been saved, we've submitted ourselves to Jesus' teaching, and we are committed to the mission that Jesus has left for us. And that's attractive to the world around us. He says that here. Sadly, though, most churches, and I'd say many churches at least, have a bad reputation for not being unified around the mission, right? Churches are often known for people with like pet projects and pet agendas and their own personal missions that they like to fight and argue and squabble about instead of being on mission with Jesus and doing whatever it takes to reach lost people. That's generally the vibe in the reputation of most churches. They get a bad rap for fighting and arguing over silly things. The comedian Jerry Clower tells a story that at a church business meeting once, everyone was gathered for this church business meeting. If you've ever been a part of a church business meeting, you know how ugly those things can get sometimes, right? They don't happen that way here because you guys are all sanctified and holy. It's great, okay? But like, that was a joke. But they don't. They in some churches, they get real ugly, okay? I grew up in a church where it could get real ugly, okay? And at this church business meeting, they were all gathered to discuss buying a new chandelier for the church. Well, there was an older man there, and they called him Uncle Versi. He had been a part of the church for a very long time, and he was there on the day of the business meeting, and he wanted to make sure that his voice was heard, and more than that, he wanted to make sure that people didn't argue over this whole chandelier thing. So the meeting began. He's sitting there in the midst of the meeting, and they all start arguing and bickering and fighting, and they start lobbing shots at each other, and it's getting really ugly really fast. And so Uncle Versi stands up in the middle of the business meeting, and he says, listen, guys, I have something I need to say, and you'll need to hear it, okay? He says, I don't know why y'all are fighting over a chandelier. He said, for one, when we go to order a chandelier, no one here even knows how to spell it, okay? He says, number two, he says, if we were able to figure out how to spell chandelier and we could get it ordered, he said, no one here even knows how to play a chandelier. And finally, he said, and most importantly, he said, why are we squabbling over a chandelier when no one knows how to spell it, no one knows how to play it, when what we desperately need in this church is more lights? Yeah, you got it, right? Now, that's funny a little, isn't it? It's funny because, sadly, it's often true in churches. People get their own selfish agendas. They get their own selfish mission that they're out to complete, and they try to get people on their side and whatever. We've got to remind our hearts that we're not on our own personal missions. We're on a mission with Jesus, and his mission was to seek and to save the lost. His mission was to create a church that was so unified that it was magnetic to the world around them so that the world wanted what we had. Look, the world outside these doors, they experience disunity everywhere else in life, at their work, in their families, in their neighborhoods, at their kids' schools. There ought to be something different about the unity that exists within these walls as a church. We ought to have a supernatural unity, not a natural disunity that can be found anywhere. But get this, let's write this down. Disunity will always be present in the church when we put our own mission before Jesus' mission. Disunity will always be present in the church when we put our own personal missions ahead of Jesus' mission to seek and to save the lost. We must be united, going towards the world around us, showing them something different, understanding that no matter what our preferences are, no matter what our pet projects are and the things we necessarily would want to see, that we're willing to sacrifice whatever it takes to reach the world around us with the gospel. That was Jesus' mission. And I'll tell you this, that was the mission of the early church. In fact, Luke wrote a book called Acts, and in Acts, he actually describes them beautifully. Let me give you the scripture as we wrap up. Acts 4, verse 32 says this. All the believers were, what's the next word? What's the next word? All the believers were one in heart and in mind. With great power, the apostles continue to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and God's grace was so powerfully at work in them all. There's actually a special measure of God's grace that is present and powerfully at work when we're unified as a church. So what was it that created that kind of unity? That early church was committed to the Great Commission Jesus left them before he ascended back to heaven. He said, go make disciples of all nations. And they were committed to that unity. They were all pointed towards the same goal, the same vision, the same mission. And that's why they were one in heart and they were one in mind. You hear me say often around here that our vision is we want to be a church where everyone is for the one. Every one of us is committed to doing whatever it takes to reach the lost ones out in our community. That means everything we do as a church is about helping ones, lost people in our community that don't know Jesus yet. We want to do anything possible in our power to help them find and follow Jesus. That's our desire as a church. And the moment we forget that and we get caught up in our little petty side missions, we will be a disunified mess that is no longer attractive or flavorful to the world around us, and we'll eventually cease to exist because we'll be a monument more than we'll be a movement. Are y'all with me? We must be a place where everyone is for the one. If we're going to be like the early church, if we're going to find unity, we must remember that our mission to reach the lost is first and foremost above all things. Our mission is what creates our unity, and our unity is what helps accomplish our mission of reaching the lost. Look, I don't know about you. I want to be unified so we can accomplish the mission. I want us to be unified so we can accomplish the vision that God has given us. I want to be a place where that special measure of God's grace that was mentioned there in Acts is powerfully at work in our midst, because we are uniquely unified as a church. I want to see people saved, added to our number daily. I want to see our city impacted. I want to see marriages salvaged because of the grace of Jesus. I want to see families restored because of the grace and power that's at work in us because of Jesus and because of the unique unity that we possess as a church. But the only way we get to experience that kind of unity, the only way we get to experience that kind of power, is when we'll be committed to Jesus' mission instead of our own side missions. Are y'all with me? We must be committed to what Jesus was committed to, seeking and saving the lost no matter the cost. Seeking and saving the lost no matter the cost. And so I would ask you this today. Are you on mission with Jesus today, or have you been sidetracked with your own mission or agenda? Let me close with this and we'll be finished. A.W. Tozer, in his great book, The Pursuit of God, he explained unity like this. Listen closely. Has it ever occurred to you, he says, that 100 pianos all tuned to the same fork are automatically tuned to each other? They are of one accord. They are one by being tuned not to each other, but to another standard to which each one must individually bow. So in the same way, 100 believers gathering together, what we're doing today, each one looking away from themselves and looking to Christ, are in heart nearer to each other than they could ever possibly be on their own. It's powerful, isn't it? That's a powerful oneness, a powerful unity. Are you willing to bow to Jesus today, believer? Are you willing to bow to Jesus? It happens in the three ways that we discuss from Jesus' prayer. Are you willing to bow to Him and be saved if you've never been saved? Are you willing to place genuine faith in Jesus' message, the gospel, so that you can experience unity on the inside? Then are you willing to bow to Jesus and be submitted to Jesus' teachings on the outside, even if you don't understand it? And then are you willing to be committed to Jesus' mission worldwide so that we can see the world reached and saved and their lives changed, so that we can impact the city where God has planted us? Listen, this is what Jesus prays for you and for me and for His church. And this is the only place where true unity can be found. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank You for Your word. Use it to impact the hearts of Your people right now. Holy Spirit, take it and move in a very special way. And Father, if there be one here that doesn't know Jesus as their personal Savior, they never placed a genuine faith in Him, would You help them to give their lives to You and place their faith in You today and be saved? Father, we love You. We thank You for the unique, beautiful, supernatural unity that we can have as a church only because we've bowed to Jesus Christ. And we ask it all in Jesus' precious name. And all God's people said, amen. Let's stand to our feet.